We are now going to see how to find out the velocity profile for the Taylor-Couette flow. Here you will see that finally we will come in terms of the polar coordinate, and this is unlike the previous deduction that we did for parallel boundary case where the Cartesian coordinate was used. There is an outer circle and there is an inner circle. This one is a hollow space where we have kept a Newtonian viscous fluid, whereas this circle is basically a solid part and is a plan view of the two cylinder situation which I have already discussed. Now here we consider a line before deformation as OAB. O is the center of both the circles, so it's a concentric circular situation. Now imagine that the outer circular arc is rotated with an angular velocity minus omega 1. This is applied on the outer boundary, and in the inner boundary, inner circular boundary has been rotated with a velocity minus omega 2. Note that both are in the negative sign has been given. That means both of their rotation directions are the same. If they were rotating in opposite direction, I would have given opposite sign. Now here on the OAB line, after such a rotation can attain the position OA dash B dash. For certain amount of omega 1, omega 2 and the radius and the distances OA and AB, it is possible that OAB straight line will also be OA dash B dash straight line. If I draw a tangent at B dash, which is this arrow, then V theta is the velocity at that point B dash. Now in this situation, angle BOB dash means this angle, which is acute angle here, is called as the meridional angle. V theta is the linear velocity of the fluid. V theta is the linear velocity of the fluid in the azimuthal direction. Which fluid? The fluid which is in contact with the upper boundary. Here we are considering a no slip boundary condition. That means if the outer boundary is rotating with some angular velocity or with some linear velocity, the same velocity will be picked up by the fluid which is in contact with that boundary. There is no lagging behind of the fluid due to this rotation. What happens if there is a slip boundary condition? That can be an altogether different topic of discussion. Now consider small r as a distance from the center where velocity is measured. Suppose I want to know at this point k how much is the velocity attained because of such a deformation. In that case, the OK distance will be called as r unit. Since our area of interest is between these two circular arcs, I can say that the r value is either equal to OA. If it is so, then I am considering the point A, or more than OA, that means say some points here. It can also be equal to OB. Suppose this point B's journey we want to demonstrate, or it is less than OB, that means within this domain. So when we say r equal to distance from center where velocity is measured, we implicitly mean this as well. Now here we write down the starting differential equation as d square v theta dr square plus ddr v theta r is equal to 0. From here we are going to start. Now if this equation is integrated twice, you can get v theta equal to c1 r by 2 plus c2 by r, where c1 and c2 are the integration constants. Now we will take the two boundary conditions. At r equal to r1, v theta is equal to minus r1 omega 1. So where is r1 in this diagram? This is the r1, the radius of the outer circular arc or the outer circle. And at r equal to r2, v theta we consider as r2 omega 2. Now note that here we are considering minus omega 1 as the angular speed and plus omega 2 as the angular speed. Since there is a minus and plus terms involved, this means that their rotation senses are opposite. Here you can see that the outer circle is rotating in an anti-clockwise direction. So we put a minus symbol, and here plus omega 2, which is moving in a clockwise direction. If both were moving in this direction, I would have taken minus omega 1, minus omega 2. If both were moving in this direction, I would have taken plus omega 1 and plus omega 2. Now, yes, that's what I write here. The boundaries move here in opposite direction. Now, we put these values in the equation, solve C1 and C2. C1, C2, and then write them back in this equation. Then we finally get V theta is equal to omega 1 plus omega 2, the sum of the angular speed multiplied by R1 square, R2 square. R1 and R2 are demonstrated. R1 I have stated. This is R2 distance. So the space where the deformation is happening, this much. What is this thickness? It is, and obviously we are speaking this. So this much I said, and then divide by R1 square minus R2 square multiplied by R inverse, then minus, and then third bracket, first bracket, R1 square omega 1 plus R2 square omega 2 divided by R1 square minus R2 square. You can see this R1 square minus R2 square can be taken as common. 1 divided by that can be taken as common and can be kept outside. Here it is multiplied by R. I would request the listeners and the students to deduce this. Solve C1, C2, put it here and you will get this equation. Now, how the line will behave if such a rotation has been taken? This blue line will look like this. This is a common sense, right? Because this inner circle is rotating in this way. So this point will come here, that point will come there. So that is the expected nature of the curve. Here, remember, we are dealing with a Newtonian viscous fluid. And just to recollect, what is a Newtonian viscous fluid? Stress is proportional to strain rate, which I have already discussed. Okay. Now, as I have drawn this orange curve, we can call it a profile, which can be a displacement profile. Only one point has not moved at all. What is that point? This is the point which has not moved at all. So we can call this as the neutral point. In the next instant, how the curve will look like? And as the diagram is getting clumsy, it is right time to redraw the diagram. At one instant and at another instant. And where is the neutral point now? This is the point which does not change its position. Recollect how the neutral point was defined in case of a couette flow in horizontal shear zone. Here is a line, you apply a shear, and that line becomes like this. So this is the neutral point. Here, what is the major change? Since the boundaries are curvilinear, therefore the velocity profile is getting a curved line. Here it was straight line moving as a straight line. So this is the neutral point, a point which does not move during deformation. Only when both the boundaries have moved in opposite direction. Okay, now how to find out its coordinate? Its coordinate r theta, and for that we need to put v theta equal to 0, because at that point no velocity, v theta has to be 0. So our expression will be r comma 0. So I can put 0, v theta equal to 0 here, and solve r. And then write down that R value here, which is plus minus R1 R2 multiplied by omega 1 plus omega 2 divided by R1 square omega 1 plus R2 square omega 2. And then what is given in the second bracket is done a square root, and then comma 0. So that is written. So here also I am requesting the viewer, you must do it by your own. You must put V theta equal to 0 and get the R value. Now, see, there are two values are possible. Whereas in my diagram, I am seeing only single value. So out of these two, plus minus two values, I have to choose a single value that lies inside the shear zone. So in this way, the neutral point can be derived. Now we are going to discuss more about the neutral point. I have discussed already in one of my lectures that when the shear zone is of parallel boundaries and no Poiseuille flow is acting and the boundaries are sheared with a velocity say plus u1 and minus u2, where the neutral point will lie. And in a special case when u1 and u2 magnitude wise are the same, say 3 millimeter per year and 3 millimeter per year in nature, or 3 millimeter per 5 minutes and 3 millimeter per 5 minutes in the laboratory, then you can find out that the neutral point is equidistant from both the boundaries. And if u2 is actually 0, the neutral point comes here. If u1 is 0, then the neutral point comes over there. If u1 is more than u2, in that case, where the neutral point will go? The neutral point will go closer to the lower boundary, and if u2 is much larger than u1, then the neutral point comes close to the upper boundary. These can be understood from the velocity profile of such a flow. Now we want to compare such a deformation with the Taylor-Couette flow, which is a circular simple shear. We have already seen the coordinate of the neutral point, which is here. The question is, suppose where this rotation is with an angular speed minus omega 1, that is with plus omega 2, suppose I take their magnitudes as the same, just like to make thing comparable with the Couette flow with parallel boundaries and horizontal situation, where I consider u1 equal to u2. In circular simple shear case, suppose I take their magnitudes are the same, but their rotation senses are opposite, like this is going anti-clockwise, this one is rotating in a clockwise sense. Will I get the neutral point equidistant from these boundaries? For example, if I start with this line, am I going to get the neutral point here? In other words, if this point is A, this point is B, and this is neutral point, will this happen that the NA length equal to the NB length? Now this can be checked very easily. Here I can put omega 1 equal to omega 2 straight away. If I put omega 1 equal to omega 2, I will not find that that point, the neutral point, is coming necessarily at the middle position. To be the neutral point necessarily in the middle position, that means NA equal to NB, there has to be a certain combination of the magnitude of omega 1, magnitude of omega 2, the R value, etc. Then I think the R1 value and also the R2 value. All these values, there for certain combination only, this is there. Whereas here, that is not the case. If u1, u2 are equal, whatever be the thickness here, which we were constantly considering as 2y0 unit, the neutral point will be equidistant from the boundaries. Where do we use the Taylor-Couette flow? In structural geology, sometimes there is lack of space in the laboratory. So instead of having profound simple shearing, for that we need a very long table and the shear apparatus with parallel boundaries, and the boundaries will move for a long time, space issue comes. What is the advantage in the structural geology with the Taylor-Couette flow experiment is that we can keep two circular boundaries with common center, and we can rotate these boundaries as much as possible, producing very high strain over a small experimental area. So this is one of the advantages and the reason why structural geologists use sometimes the Taylor-Couette flow. But also to admit that when the structural geologists are working the shear deformation and analog model and simulation in the laboratory, mostly they are using parallel boundary case. Very rarely and only in few labs the Taylor-Couette flow facility is available. And as I mentioned earlier, this is, by the way, available mostly in the mechanical and the civil engineering department. In my previous lecture, I have already given you a glimpse of layered simple shear zone with parallel boundary. Right, I drew such a line and I said that there is layer 1 and layer 2, top boundary shear, say bottom boundary static, then this kind of velocity profile is expected. Now, a condition similar to this we can think in terms of the Taylor-Couette flow also. Consider the outer circle and the inner circle, and here is the common center. Now think of there is a contact between two fluids A and B with viscosities mu A and mu B and the density rho A and rho B. Now imagine the inner boundary is rotated in this way. I will take it as a positive, and the outer boundary is rotated in that direction, in opposite direction, and I take it as a negative omega value. In that case, how the velocity profile will look like, or the displacement profile will look like, I can draw an initial marker orientation and we will consider that between these two boundaries there is no slip of the marker unit. You can consider here this point in our previous example, or rather this point is having a single velocity for both layer 1 and 2, or the contact moves at a same rate. Same concept can be brought over here, and how the velocity profile or the displacement profile will look like. Now I am going to apply common sense and see how the neutral point will be located if the different directions of rotations of the circular boundaries are done in a Taylor-Couette flow, and common sense will be sufficient to do it. Suppose the outer boundary is rotated in this direction given by minus omega 1 angle, and the inner boundary also rotates in the same direction with minus omega 2 angular speed, and I take this as a starting line, undeformed marker before the deformation started. Since this inner boundary rotates in this way, so this point must come here after some time, and let's take the omega 1 magnitude to be more than the omega 2 magnitude. So this point will travel a lot of distance, say it has come over there. So the profile, or maybe I take it further, say I bring it here. So this point A has come to A dash, point B has come to B dash. How the profile will look like? The AB length has increased from a straight line one to a curve one. Very obviously A dash B dash curve length is more than the AB straight line length, and we observe that the green profile does not intersect the initial AB line within the shear zone. So in this case, where is the neutral point? I can extend this straight line inside, and I can also extend this green line, and we see that the neutral point goes outside the curve shear zone. This is comparable with the case that I take horizontal shear zone, no Poiseuille flow, only simple shear on the boundaries. In that case, both the boundaries shear with the in the same direction with different velocity u1 more than u2, just like this situation. Then this is the profile. So where is the neutral point? Neutral point goes outside the shear zone. Same thing has happened over here. Okay, if I change the directions of the shear and still maintain such a relation, what will happen? Say this and this. Bigger half arrow means greater velocity, smaller half arrow means lower velocity than the upper boundary. So in this case, this is the profile, and the neutral point again goes outside. Same thing will happen, absolutely common sense thing, if we consider two circular boundaries, and now we are shearing this with the velocity, with the angular speed plus omega 1, why plus? Because the direction is opposite. Here we are considering in all the time that whenever there is a clockwise rotation, I am considering omega to be more than 0 or positive, and whenever there is an anti-clockwise rotation, then omega to be less than 0. So, maintaining the same concept, this is positive omega 1, and then here I give a rotation here as positive omega 2, and maintain the same relation where will be the neutral point. Let us try to understand. Again, I consider a marker. The marker ideally passes through the center. Here my diagram went little bit bad. Actually, this point has to be, this line has to pass through the center of both the circles. Okay, so now this point after a lot of rotation comes over say here, and this point only comes over there, then this is the profile, and we can see this blue curve is not meeting this line. So, and if we extend this curve, the neutral point goes outside the shear zone. Which is comparable with such situations. So, in this way, absolutely common sense things, but I am drawing for the geology student so that no ambiguity remains. Suppose this is the initial marker, this bold line is a marker, and by faint line, by extending it, I am saying that the marker passes through the center of both the circles, and you are only shearing the outer boundary with a velocity minus omega 1 and maintaining here omega 2 equal to 0. That means this inner circle is not rotating. Where the neutral point will go? So this point comes over there, and that point does not change its position, or let us say this point comes over further here, that point does not change. So this is the profile, and the boundary that is static, on that itself the neutral point lies. Now I am going to draw a Taylor-Couette flow situation, and I am going to ask you where the neutral point will be plotted. Say these are the two circular boundaries of the shear zone, and then this boundary is rotated with a velocity plus omega 1, and this boundary is static. Here is the marker where the neutral point will be located, and can you draw the profile? You can stop the video here and draw, and then run the video and check whether you are able to do. I hope you did so, and here is the solution. Pretty simple. So this point has gone over here, this point remains same. So this is expected to be the velocity profile, and the neutral point is on the static boundary. The same principle will work. Imagine that the outer boundary is static and the inner boundary is rotated in that clockwise direction, and say this is the marker. How the profile will look like and where the neutral point will be plotted? I would request again, stop the video, very simple thing, but nevertheless stop the video, check, and then again you cross check what I am doing. I hope you stop the video for a while, and here is the solution. This point has not at all moved, whereas this point has come, let us say, over here. So the profile will be like this, and on the static boundary lies the neutral point. Similarly, if the inner circular boundary is rotated in this direction, and here is the marker, and the outer boundary is kept as static, in that case, where the neutral point will plot? This point has come over here. So this is the profile, and therefore here lies the neutral point. So I have very briefly discussed the Taylor-Couette flow. It will be interesting for the geoscience students to explore its detail. How much can be the shear heat produced or the viscous dissipation when the Taylor-Couette flow is taking place for certain viscosity and density of the material. We have considered the flow is happening in plan. We are observing in plan. There are two circular arcs and they are rotating. What will happen if the situation is like this? We have taken two cylinders in an inclined situation, still maintaining them concentric, and they have a common axis right now. And suppose the outer boundary is rotated with some speed, the inner boundary is maybe rotated in opposite direction. How the velocity profile and the displacement profile will be seen within this domain can be an open question. I repeat here, whatever I was doing, the equation that was written and the derivation of neutral point, all was true when the flow is taking place on a horizontal plane. And by the way, we have not discussed today about the flow taking place as observed in vertical section. All our discussion today was on the plan section. Here, how the flow is happening, we were trying to explore. So please do not mix up things. While studying the Taylor-Couette flow and the profile visualization and actually deriving the velocity profile, we can now go for the strain analysis from the Taylor-Couette flow for such situations where the axis of the cylinders are vertical and both the axis for them basically superpose. In that case, how to do strain analysis? Let's have a look. So here I will give you some hint. So we start like this, again two concentric circle, and then is a hollow space full of fluid. I am looking at a plan section, plan view, and this is the marker before deformation. Now we can draw tiny circular markers inside in this way, say of equal radius, and now apply a shear and keep this boundary static. These circles will become ellipse. Will it be homogeneous deformation? What do you think? So again, you may stop the video for a while, think, and then run the video and check. This is important. What you are thinking, is it matching with common sense? Before running experiments also, sometimes we have to visualize, and it will be an interesting thing what I am thinking, visualizing, not always from the equations. Is it matching with the reality? I hope you pause the video, and here the answer is, due to this circular couette flow, these circles will not become ellipses. They will attain irregular geometry. These circular markers will attain irregular geometry, which means that we are dealing with non-homogeneous deformation. And just to recollect, if we consider parallel boundary, horizontal situation, and no pressure gradient, and only a simple shear component where a straight line alters to another straight line, we can take a big circle and it will become an ellipse. That is a homogeneous deformation. So what we understand is that in such situation, a simple shear is a homogeneous deformation, and under such situation where the boundaries are curved, is a non-homogeneous or an inhomogeneous deformation. So what was done for a single viscous fluid here, you can also consider a two layers with fluid 1 and fluid 2, and also watch how these circular markers behaving. One way is to run the analog model, another is to run the analytical model, or you can simply write equations and keep proceeding, finding out the irregular geometries of these circular markers. Let's try to understand the neutral point and the neutral line in the two cases, the case with parallel wall and, let's say in this case, a couette shear is happening, both the walls are moving in the same direction. So here the profile will tilt like that. If I extend these two lines, they will meet outside the shear zone. This point can be called as a neutral point, and the line drawn through the neutral point and parallel to the boundary can be called as a neutral line. Where is the neutral point here? When the bottom boundary is static, top is moving, this point is the neutral point. And what is the neutral line? Here is the neutral line itself superposes with the lower boundary. What happens if both the boundaries are sheared? Then this line alters to that line, and in that case this is the neutral point. If I draw a line passing through the neutral point parallel to the boundary, it can be called as a neutral line. What has happened? Above the neutral line, all the material points are going to the right hand side. Below the neutral line, all the material points going to the left hand side. So across the neutral line, the direction of movement of the material alters, takes 180 degree opposite movement in this specific case. What about this situation? Top boundary shears top to left up, and this boundary shears down in this way. There is a effective pressure gradient pushing the fluid up so that the straight line alters to a parabolic profile. Where they intersect, this point can be called as a neutral point, and a line drawn through the neutral point parallel to the boundary can be called neutral line. We can clearly see above the neutral line all material points moving upward, and below the neutral line all the material points are going downward direction. Now consider this Poiseuille flow, that is a net flow going upward. The parabolic profile is drawn and that intersects the boundary at the two points. These two are the neutral points. So the boundaries themselves are the neutral lines. As the neutral line plots on the shear zone boundary, therefore as you see that the concept basically matching all the material points moving in the upward direction, there is no switch in the direction of the movement of the fluid. Now I will consider these situations with the Taylor-Couette flow. Consider that the inner cylinder is static and the outer cylinder is rotating in a counterclockwise direction, so that the red marker will take such a turn. What happens? The intersection between this marker and the initial marker is the neutral point over here, which plots on the static cylinder, and a curved line drawn through the neutral point and parallel to this circle, I mean the circular arc itself. The inner circular arc itself is the neutral line. Here the neutral line is a curved line, basically a circle, whereas in these cases the neutral line was a straight line. Now take this case that the outer cylinder rotates counterclockwise and the inner cylinder rotates clockwise direction. So then this marker red line will take such a pattern. The intersection between the initial orientation of the marker and the final orientation can be called as a neutral point. If I draw a circle passing through the neutral point like this and maintaining the same center as the two given cylinders, then this green line is called the neutral line. And we can see outside this green line all material points are moving in the counterclockwise direction, whereas inside this green line we can see that all material points are moving in a clockwise direction. So the direction of movement of the material or the fluid gets altered across the neutral line. The same concept was demonstrated when there is parallel boundary shear zone. Now we will take the case of the two cylinders moving in the same direction, in the counterclockwise direction. In that case, the yellow marker after some time will take such a position. This marker, the final position, does not intersect the initial marker orientation, but if I extend that curve and if I extend this marker inside the inner solid cylinder, they will intersect, and that point can be called as a neutral point. And if I draw a circle here, the red colored circle can be called as the neutral line, or we can call it as a neutral circle if required. So in this way, the neutral point and neutral line can be compared between parallel wall shear zone and the Taylor-Couette flow situation.